Good morning and a very, very warm welcome from the Parish of Wareham in Dorset, England. It's lovely to have you join with us today on what is a glorious summer's day. And I hope wherever you are, the sun is shining, if not outside, then in your hearts. We're here to worship God and to give praise and honour to his name. So our service begins with our opening hymn.
Thank you.
We meet in the name of the living God, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. Amen. So let us say a prayer of preparation. Almighty God, to whom all hearts are open, all desires known, and from whom no secrets are hidden, cleanse the thoughts of our hearts by the inspiration of your Holy Spirit, that we may perfectly love you and worthily magnify your holy name, through Christ our Lord. Amen. And now we move into a time of confession, remembering those times when we have not loved God or our neighbour as we ought to have done. O King, enthroned on high, filling the earth with your glory, holy is your name, Lord God Almighty. In sinfulness we cry out to you to take our guilt away and to cleanse our lips to speak your word, through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. And Almighty God, who forgives all who truly repent, have mercy upon you, pardon and deliver you from all your sins, confirm and strengthen you in all goodness, and keep you in life eternal, through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. And the collect or the special prayer for today. God, our Saviour, look on this wounded world in pity and in power. Hold us fast to your promises of peace, won for us by your Son, our Saviour, Jesus Christ. Amen. And we now have our first Bible reading taken from the Epistle to the Romans, read for us by Margaret Day, and this will be followed by our second hymn.
A reading from Romans chapter 6. What shall we say then? Shall we go on sinning so that grace may increase? By no means. We are those who have died to sin. How can we live in it any longer? Or don't you know that all of us who were baptized into Christ Jesus were baptized into his death? We were therefore buried with him through baptism into death in that order. Just as Christ was raised from the dead through the glory of the Father, we too may live a new life. So if we have been united with him in a death like his, we will certainly also be united with him in a resurrection like his. For we know that our old self was crucified with him, so that the body ruled by sin might be done away with, that we should no longer be slaves to sin, because anyone who has died has been set free from sin. Now, if we died with Christ, we believe that we will also live with him. For we know that since Christ was raised from the dead, he cannot die again. Death no longer has mastery over him. The death he died to sin once for all. But the life he lives to God. In the same way, count yourselves dead to sin, but alive to God in Christ Jesus. This is the word of the Lord.
Joy of the whole world.
That gospel reading today is read for us by Maurice Turner. This will be followed by a sermon preached by the Reverend Hilary Bond.
The first lesson is from St. Matthew chapter 10, verses 24 to 39. The student is not above the teacher, nor a servant above his master. It is enough for students to be like their teachers, and servants like masters. If the head of the house has been called Beelzebub, how much more the members of his household? So do not be afraid of them, for there is nothing concealed that will not be disclosed, or hidden that will not be made known. What I tell you in the dark, speak in the daylight. What is whispered in your ear, proclaim from the roofs. Do not be afraid of those who kill the body, but cannot kill the soul. Rather, be afraid of the one who can destroy both soul and body in hell. Are not two sparrows sold for a penny? Yet not one of them will fall to the ground outside your Father's care. And even the very hairs of your head are all numbered. So do not be afraid. You are worth more than many sparrows. Whoever acknowledges me before others, I will also acknowledge before my Father in heaven. But whoever disowns me before others, I will disown before my Father in heaven. Do not suppose that I have come to bring peace to the earth. I did not come to bring peace, but a sword. For I have come to turn a man against his father, a daughter against her mother, a daughter-in-law against her mother-in-law. A man's enemies will be the members of his own household. Anyone who loves their father or mother more than me is not worthy of me. Anyone who loves their son or daughter more than me is not worthy of me. Whoever does not take up their cross and follow me is not worthy of me. Whoever finds their life will lose it. And whoever loses their life for my sake will find it. Here ends the lesson. Thanks be to God.
Those of you who have had a conversation with me on the phone recently may have noticed that I quite often finish a phone call with the words, "Bye for now." I never used to say this. My end of phone call phrase for a long time was, "See you later." But this, I discovered, can be a problem. My mum, in her later years, and more recently another elderly friend, would take this phrase literally, and if I didn't arrive at their house later in the same day, they would be on the phone asking me where I was. The problem was that in my mind, "see you later" meant I'll see you at some point in the not too distant future, like maybe later in the week or something, not that I would see them later that same day. This is a minor misunderstanding, and not one that's ever created a lasting difficulty. But misunderstanding can be serious. There is a well-known phrase, an anonymous quote that turns up all over the place, that says, "The worst distance between two people is misunderstanding." I imagine most of us can think of occasions on which we have either misunderstood or been misunderstood, and it's caused unhappiness or possibly even unpleasantness. Today's gospel reading has several verses that I think are easily misunderstood, and misunderstanding Bible verses can very easily cause distance between us and God. This is quite a challenging passage altogether, with its talk of secrets being brought into the light. the importance of fearing him who can destroy both body and soul in hell, and the potential consequences of denying Jesus before other people. But then there is a bit that I suspect many of us have struggled with, as Jesus, who in other places gets called the Prince of Peace, says, "Do not think that I have come to bring peace to the earth. I have not come to bring peace, but a sword." And then he goes on to describe battles within families and the necessity of loving God more than anything or anyone. Once upon a time, quite a long time ago, a small child of whom I was and am very fond asked me, "Who do you love more, me or God?" The question seriously took me back, and for a moment I honestly had no idea how to answer it. And I still totally believe that in the conversation that followed, I was given the words to say, as I tried to explain that it's not a case of one or the other, it's not a competition where there's a winner or a loser, but that the more I learn to love God, the more I become like Jesus, the more love I have to give to other people. So both loves get bigger at the same time. That conversation, though, was also a small battle. And had I given the wrong answer, that battle could have got bigger and potentially created a problem. But I think Jesus here is not saying that if you become a Christian, then inevitably your family is going to fall apart. But that discord is a possibility that we might need to be prepared to confront in the sort of question perhaps that I was asked, but that we may need to be prepared to confront it in the same loving, compassionate, sometimes challenging, but always God-centered way that Jesus did when he came up against people who did not love God as he did. And then, having created a slightly disturbing picture in people's minds of a warring household, Jesus goes on to say, "And whoever does not take up the cross and follow me is not worthy of me. Those who find their life will lose it, and those who lose their life for my sake will find it." Do you know, I wonder if that was another of those moments when the disciples to whom Jesus was speaking looked slightly nervously at one another, deciding perhaps that Jesus was starting to look just a bit too dangerous to get involved with. As soon as Jesus mentioned the cross, people of that time and place would probably have seen particular pictures in their minds. Criminals, the lowest of the low, carrying wooden beams through the streets, mocked and insulted by bystanders, on their way to die a painful and humiliating death. "Whoever does not take up the cross and follow me is not worthy of me." It's not really something that most normal people would want to be a part of. The people of the time heard mention of the cross, and immediately they would be thinking, fair enough, about something that was painful and horrible because that was what they saw around them. But when we talk about carrying our cross, are we talking about it in the right way? Or could we, to some extent, be misunderstanding? We've probably all heard, or maybe even said ourselves, about an illness or a difficult person in our lives, or a problematic situation, that it is a cross we have to bear. The cross for Jesus was horrible and painful and humiliating and brought death. But it was also what he had come to do. It was his purpose, God's purpose for him. So is it possible that when Jesus said to his followers, "You must be willing to carry the cross that is given to you for following me," that he wasn't saying that horrible and painful things will inevitably happen to us as Christians, but that he was saying that the part of us, the selfish part that wants our own way, which is in all of us, needs to go, to die, so that we, like Jesus, can do the thing which God has given us to do. Is it possible that whatever it is that God has given each of us to do, although it may at times be difficult and feel like a burden, at other times may be fun and exciting and freedom-giving, could that cross, which can sound quite unpleasant and scary, actually be a good thing with two sides to it? I'm not suggesting that carrying our cross should be looked at as something easy. That would also, I think, be a misunderstanding, because nowhere does Jesus say that being a Christian, being a follower of Jesus, is going to be easy. I love what I do, and I believe that what I do has been given to me by God. There are times when it's great fun and exciting and certainly freedom-giving, and there are also times when it's difficult and burdensome and frustrating. If that is the cross that has been given to me, then all of those elements are part of it. Just as for Jesus, the way of the cross led to fulfillment and completion of God's plan, so it is for us. So I guess my prayer for all of us today is that as we read scripture, we will read it carefully and with discernment and lots of wondering about our understanding of what we read, and also with total openness to what God might be saying to us through his written word, and that we might, as far as possible, avoid the misunderstanding that can separate us from God. Amen.
Our intercessions today are led for us by Jean Dixon, and these will be followed by our final hymn.
Let us pray. We pray for all Christians throughout the world. Please give us all the courage to speak about our faith clearly and boldly. Help us, Lord, to celebrate the differences in our ways of worshipping you, from the quiet to the loud, the ancient to the modern, the liturgical and the silent. We pray, Lord, that we may all learn from one another as you reveal yourself to each one of us. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. Today we're in the middle of Refugee Week, and it's a week to celebrate the courage of those who've been forced to flee their own lands for any reason, and who have gone on to enrich the communities they have found refuge in, enrich them with their creativity and hard work. We pray for those who cannot find a new home and who are forced to live in tented communities for many, many years. Dear Lord God, we know that in years to come there are going to be more and more refugees, as climate change and wars force people from their homes. And we pray that the governments of the world will find humane ways to help these people whose needs are so extreme. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. We pray for Solveig as she leaves us. This is her last weekend in the parish. We pray, Lord, that her ministry in the years to come will be richly blessed, and that those she encounters will be blessed also. Thank you for her ministry among us. And we pray for our clergy, for strength and wisdom in the next few months, and for guidance for whoever you have chosen to be the next vicar. We pray now, Lord, for those who are not well or in need of our prayers. We pray for your blessing for all who are ill or suffering. for those who are lonely, for those who are worried about finding money to pay the mortgage or to pay the rent, for those who are caring for sick relatives or friends, for those who are trying to support friends who are going through a time of great trial. And we pray now, Lord, for those we know who are not well. We pray, Lord, for healing for these friends of ours. Shall we say the Our Father together? Our Father in heaven, hallowed be your name. Your kingdom come, your will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us today our daily bread. Forgive us our sins, as we forgive those who sin against us. Lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For the kingdom, the power, and the glory are yours, now and forever. Amen.
God, the Holy Trinity, make you strong in faith and love, defend you on every side and guide you in truth and peace. And the blessing of God Almighty, the Father, the Son and the Holy Spirit, be upon you and all whom you love, this day and for evermore. Amen. Go in peace to love and serve the Lord in the name of Christ. Amen. And may God be with you in all that you do this week. May you know his love surrounding you. Amen.